So after traveling back in time, we end up in the era of the Cold War. It's October 1957, and the Soviet Union is launching Sputnik, the first artificial satellite to enter Earth's orbit. And this will solidify the start of their space race against the United States. As part of this big scientific contest, one of the milestones is to launch a man into space. But to do that, they need to test the effects of spaceflight on living beings. The Soviets sent out dogs while Americans used apes, but in our alternate timeline, we introduce a new species to the space race. Vampires. Welcome to Anime Science, where we look at science fiction concepts in anime, see how accurate they are in reality, and how weird we could get with them. This episode is based on Irina the Vampire Cosmonaut, and includes topics like human biology, the vacuum of space, hematology, which is the study of blood, the effects of sunlight, and the science behind vampires. Keep in mind, I'm not a biologist or physicist or anything like that. I'm just an anime nerd with a computer science degree that likes to break down complex ideas. If you have a better understanding of these concepts covered in the video, feel free to leave a comment down below. Let's start by explaining the anime. In it, the Soviets take a vampire girl named Irina Luminescu and train her to be a cosmonaut, which sounded like an awesome concept because I was thinking this was used as a secret advantage against the US. There's gotta be some kind of cool science reason for it, right? But unfortunately, they only used Irina because she's close to being human, but not enough to care if she died. In fact, there's not much difference between vampires and humans in the show. Vampires can drink blood, but it's more of a cultural ritual now. They can eat regular food, but they can't taste or smell. They're barely weak to sunlight, and they aren't even immortal creatures, meaning they're basically a different race of humans seen as cursed by the world. In the end, the Soviets are basically just racist and worried about their reputation. They don't want their first manned flight to end in failure to the public, so her being a vampire has nothing to do with going to space. It's just an excuse in the story to have an adorable vampire waifu. And that's all the weebs really want. But the anime does make a lot of accurate references to the real-life space race, the biggest of which is the story of Laika, a dog that the Soviets sent into space. Only a month after Sputnik launched, they rushed to send out Sputnik 2 with a dog on board. The launch was a success, but they didn't have technology to actually bring Laika home, so she died in space. Initially, the government said Laika died painlessly when the oxygen ran out after 7 days, but years later, it was revealed she actually died after about 2 hours from overheating when the air conditioning system failed. It's a sad story, but it's thematically important to this anime because it mirrors how the Soviets treat vampires as expendable test subjects. Now, to see if there are any actual benefits to a vampire space program, we first need to look at the science behind vampires. These are largely seen as supernatural creatures born from centuries worth of superstition and storytelling. As such, there are many different types of vampires throughout fiction, and with each type comes a number of traits, powers, and weaknesses, a lot of which are either not relevant here or just too wacky to be anything but fiction. So let's define exactly what a vampire means to us. For the purpose of this video, we'll be looking at the more common and relevant aspects. Vampires are undead humans with eternal life. Their bodies are technically corpses that constantly need blood to live. Vampires typically die from sunlight, so they're usually active at night, and they also have fangs to help consume blood right from the source. Now, with all that established, let's apply science explanations to all of this. At their core, vampire bodies work the same as human bodies. Both need blood circulating to keep their organs functioning, but with vampires, their body is constantly on the verge of death. And the reason for this is that their body no longer produces blood on its own. In a regular human body, blood is made through bone marrow, which is the spongy part on the inside of our bones. With vampires, it's likely that their bone marrow can't produce blood cells anymore, and this is why they would need to physically consume blood to survive. The vampire curse is really just some kind of bone marrow disease. How much blood would a vampire need? Well, that's easy. It'd just be the same as the human version of that body, and that mostly depends on its size. However, drinking blood wouldn't be that effective at giving them the amount they need. The blood would have to go through their digestive system and eventually be absorbed into their bloodstream after it's been broken down, which means they'd have to drink a lot more blood than if they were to directly inject it into their veins, possibly more than their stomach can physically hold. And that's where vampire fangs can come into play. Like the fangs of a snake, which are hollow and hold poison, it's possible that vampire fangs can directly suck blood into their system. Once that's done, their heart pumps the blood all over their body so it continues to function. Oh, and also, no one really talks talks about this, but vampires would need blood types compatible with them. A mismatched blood transfusion can cause a body to fight the new blood as if it's an infection. If a vampire drank blood normally, this wouldn't be a problem, but that's only because most of the proteins would be destroyed during its digestive journey. And those proteins are kind of one of the main points of the blood. Now, while their bone marrow is diseased, their heart is essentially working overtime. And through that process, two things also change. They heal faster, and they become weak to sunlight. Wounds heal through the help of blood cells forming clots, protecting from infection, removing dead cells, and building new tissue. The sudden injection of a lot of blood into their system could strengthen this process significantly, and that's probably because the heart has to work harder to pump blood everywhere. This could also explain why vampires live longer than humans. But something about this process also overproduces something called porphyrins, which essentially help carry oxygen in red blood cells. When the body has too much of these, it can become sensitive to sunlight, which would explain why vampires are weak to sunlight. So to summarize how a vampire body works, they're the same as a human, but they can't produce blood due to a bone marrow disease. So they use fangs to inject blood into their body, which causes their heart to constantly work more than usual. This sudden process makes them heal fast, but also weak to sunlight. Now, I'm not a cardiologist, so I can only assume there's a ton of flaws in some of that logic that I'm missing, but we're here to focus more on how a vampire body would be affected by space. So let's just move on with all of this in mind. And that brings us to the main questions you'd probably have about a vampire space program, some of which you'll know the answer to already based on how vampire bodies would function. Our main goal is to see what the benefits of sending vampires to space instead of humans would be. So let's pack up some blood and send a vampire into space and see what happens. To start, won't sunlight kill vampires, especially in space? Maybe after a long time of direct exposure, but they won't turn into ashes instantly. And that also applies to humans. Vampire bodies have more of an allergy to sunlight. Because they're producing too many porphyrins, vampire bodies would have more of an allergy to sunlight, making their skin inflamed and itchy. So it's not the worst thing that could happen. However, it's true that sunlight in space is more harmful than usual. The sun is constantly emitting ultraviolet light, which is a kind of electromagnetic radiation. Too much exposure to UV light can damage living tissue, and that causes things like sunburns. Back on Earth, we have the ozone layer, which is a thin part of our atmosphere that absorbs most of the sun's ultraviolet light. Out in space, however, you don't have that protection through the atmosphere. In the end, the sun is dangerous for humans too, which is why spaceship windows have special tinting, and spacesuit helmets are basically giant sunglasses. But what if our vampire needs to sleep during the day? How does that work in space? On Earth, we typically have 12 hours of light and dark due to how the planet rotates and revolves around the sun. In a space shuttle orbiting Earth, this would be vastly different. For example, the International Space Station orbits Earth every 90 minutes, which causes them to experience 45 minutes of light and dark. That's about 16 sunrises per day. And this isn't something you can just look at a clock to help with, because that would mess with your circadian rhythm, which is what signals your body to sleep or wake up. Because of this process, when there's less light, your body makes more melatonin, which makes you drowsy. But since the light and dark is circulating so often in space, it will physically mess with your body. A lot of astronauts suffer from insomnia in space because their internal clock gets messed up. So if a vampire body was cursed to sleep at night, they might have to constantly sleep every 45 minutes, and that would kind of be a problem. How about oxygen? Do space vampires need it since they're undead? Yes. They absolutely do. A lot of fiction would tell you vampires are immortal creatures that can never die as long as their heart works. But that, of course, doesn't work if you look at them scientifically. But even if we somehow assume they only need their heart and blood to survive, they would still need oxygen. See, blood has many functions during its journey, like removing waste materials and spreading nutrients. But one of the most important functions of blood is that it carries oxygen around the system. The process goes like this. Lungs oxygenate blood, which is then sent to the left side of your heart and then the rest of your body. After that blood is deoxygenated, it goes to the right side of the heart and then returns to the lungs for more oxygen. The main reason we die without oxygen is because of cerebral hypoxia, which is when the brain doesn't receive enough oxygenated blood to keep it alive. Within seconds of deoxygenated blood in the brain, humans go unconscious. Death will then occur within 5 to 10 minutes of lack of oxygen. So a super heart working overtime won't save a vampire from dying without oxygen. Even if they're undead, bodies require oxygen to function. It's kind of the main point of blood in the first place anyways. But if we ignore oxygen, can a vampire survive the cold of space? The short answer is no. The long answer is that space doesn't kill you from its temperature. Its lack of air pressure does. Temperature is essentially a measurement of how atoms move. If they're fast, then it's hot. If they're slow, then it's cold. But in space, the atoms don't move, which means we're at absolute zero. So for all intents and purposes, space has no temperature. The only real way you gain or lose heat is through radiation. Sunlight will make you hotter over time, but without it, you'll slowly lose body heat as a biological side effect. It's not at all like the movies where everything instantly freezes when you go into space. Now, the sudden shift to near zero air pressure is the real problem here. The decompression it causes would make the air in your lungs expand and then rupture unless the air is exhaled immediately. But even if you survive that, the pressure change also causes ebullism, which is when the boiling temperature of bodily fluids gets lowered. That quickly turns liquid water in the body into water vapor, and from that, you get an embolism, which is when gas bubbles block your arteries and prevent blood flow, which is a big problem, especially for vampires. So in the end, there aren't many benefits to a vampire space program, at least not if we look at how vampires would technically work. And so despite how Irina the Vampire Cosmonaut disappointed me for not exploring these ideas, it was right not to in the end, because vampires are basically the same as regular humans, and space is very dangerous to anyone. So apologies to Elon Musk and Jeff Bezos if you came here looking for new candidates. Anyways, thank you all so much for watching. I had a blast researching for this, but it was tough because, surprisingly enough, vampires aren't real. I know, it's crazy, right? So if you enjoyed this video, or if you have any other questions about space vampires, let me know in the comments down below. And subscribe to the channel for more anime science content. I'm looking to focus on all kinds of sci-fi topics in the future, which I hope you'll find interesting as well. You can also check out my anime takes on Twitter, or see some big brain memes in my Discord. And if you really enjoy my content, consider supporting me on Patreon, where every dollar helps fund my mozzarella stick space program so I can study the effects of cheese in space. Together, we can make an appetizer that's out of this world. That's all for this video. I'll talk to you guys later.